So welcome to the first episode of The Mac Show with me, Nicholas Hill.
Me, Nicky Curtis.
So the idea with this show was really we wanted to add another stream to the IT Idiots Network. So this podcast is going to go out as part of the IT Idiots Network. We currently do a podcast looking at enterprise technology and some of the more in-depth subjects on the Windows platform. And we felt that we'd like to now start doing something on the Mac.
Yeah.
Purely from a hobbyist point of view. Is that the right word? The person is probably not right.
So, I suppose it is hobbyist. I think that's probably a good enough description.
Certainly from a personal interest. So our backgrounds are a Windows platform.
Certainly Windows, yeah.
Windows. We then really got into the Macs through using them as the Mac Minis for home theatre.
Yeah.
And we've just bought copious numbers of Macs ever since. So the idea of the show really is going to be to try and, I guess, put out 30 minutes every week. And what we're going to do is we'll look at the OS X and we'll also look at applications and demo those. I mean, that's our forte, really, isn't it? The screen capture with the video, taking a look at, as I say, the operating system and applications. Mm-hmm. And we thought we'd start the episode, start the new show, by, I guess, looking at the new iMacs.
Yep, that's so, the place to start.
We went out and we bought one just for the show.
Well, you did.
Well, I did.
Okay, I'm still on an old MacBook.
But you're looking at upgrading that to, what are you looking at getting?
I'm looking at upgrading to the Mac Pro, the 15-inch one. 17 is too big for me. But I think, we're so close to Leopard, it probably doesn't make wise sense to buy one now. You save £100, I suppose, won't you?
Yeah. So, that's probably the other thing worth mentioning if you haven't already got it. We're based in the UK, so there won't be a huge amount of iPhone-related material.
No, apart from, when we get it. But, it's probably worth mentioning that O2 are getting it now in England.
Yeah, the O2 network are going to be having the new iPhones. You're already thinking about getting one, aren't you?
I'm probably going to get one mainly because of I'm a big iPod user.
Yeah,
and
we love our iPods.
Do like iPods. So if these iPods that are apparently meant to be coming out soon, and more of that in Mo, I guess. If they're any good, probably not so interested.
Yeah, that'll be interesting. I mean, because I was reading, I think you were reading the same article, weren't you, over on, I think it was Ars Technica, somewhere like this.
Yeah,
that's right. We're looking at possibly some information on 5th of September. New iPods are rumoured to be launched.
Well, that's what they all say, yeah. There's plenty of all the Apples on the 5th of September, we reckon.
Yeah.
Everyone's saying it's iPod. I really hope it's Leopard. I don't think it is, because not one rumour site has mentioned, it could be Leopard, but I don't know, let's hope it's Leopard.
I mean, I think it makes sense. The iPods are probably due for basically a new revision. I mean, don't get me wrong, I absolutely love my iPod and it works perfectly, but I can see that there is a big market there for a widescreen iPod to be able to, I guess, have your movies on the go in widescreen.
Yeah, it makes sense, doesn't it?
And there's always going to be that market of people, and I think I probably fall into that category. I want a device that does my music and maybe portable video.
While you're driving.
that's very true, but
let's not go there.
Let's not go there. And I don't necessarily want my phone integrated into that. Now, obviously, we haven't seen the iPhone, so I know people say it really works, but at the moment I'm still in the camp of I would like an iPod device for video and music.
I mean, I would rush out and buy one, but the other thing that's a bit annoying for me is I work in the Windows world. So I've got Exchange servers and it syncs with a smartphone device, which are good, they're getting better.
Yep.
But the iPhone is going to give me a little bit of a headache to sync with that work. Well, I could do it via Entourage syncing to iCal, blah, 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 I imagine.
Yeah.
But that's the one reason I won't rush out and buy one.
But I mean, you have a personal mobile phone and a work mobile, don't you?
This is true.
So yeah. I mean, keep your eyes peeled. We may get one on the show, but
we definitely get one for the show, eh?
I would think so. So this week, last week got hold of the new iMac. Still getting to grips with the size of the thing. I think. What should we do? Should we pause at this point, get it up onto the into the display, and we'll take a look at it. So I guess the first thing to say is it's quite big.
It is quite a big thing, isn't it?
Yeah. We sort of just about fit round the side of it.
So what model is this? This is obviously the 24-inch.
This is the 24-inch iMac 2.4. I didn't go for the 2.8, well, for two reasons. Firstly, cost. I think it was an extra £150 for the processor. I didn't feel it was worth the upgrade to the 2.8.
But it does say extreme. Didn't you think that was worth it?
Well, maybe. But the thing that really sold me on not getting it, they didn't have it. They didn't have it. So Yeah, as you can see, she's big. I don't really know how else we can. We're going to go around the side, or we're going to have to turn this baby on its side.
Can we flick on its side?
We can. Yeah. Which way do you want? We show it on. Do you want to just move?
Let's do a profile. That'd be like, oh, look, that's like one of the Apple videos.
Look at that.
Do you see they had to pull that tag? Originally they said you can never be too thin or too beautiful.
Yeah.
But apparently loads of people were yakking outside the Apple store, you know, with bulimia and stuff. So yes. It didn't go down too well.
So there we go. I mean, we can actually now talk a little bit. I mean, you can see it's big.
It is.
I mean, you've got your obviously, that's ultra portable.
Yeah, I wonder if it's thicker. Uh-oh.
So it's thin. Obviously, they're tilt for anyone. I mean, this is obviously, we're talking people here, maybe a little bit, who haven't seen these before or haven't actually played with one. I will say, I'm sold on this.
But the keyboard.
Yeah, the little thin keyboard. At first, I wasn't so sure about it. I think it works quite well. I have certainly had no issues with wrist problems in typing.
You've got quite strong wrists there, you know.
Maybe. And to be honest with you, wired, I know people are going to go, what's that all about? Didn't we lose that a few years ago? I'm starting to think I prefer it. I'm constantly changing the bloody batteries
Bluetooth
keyboard and mouse. And it doesn't cause me a problem having a little wire here. Maybe it's
That's all the wires you've got, isn't it?
Yeah, that's it.
The power.
And obviously the power,
which you can probably see, and that's it. That's all the wires.
I mean, if we turn this around and maybe... you're not going to see this so well, but what I'll do is I'll pull up a shot from the Apple Web Store, from the Apple website. You've literally just got a bank of connectors in the back here. So this is the 2.4. It's got a 256 megabyte video card in there. I think from some of the people that and some of the reviews I've read on the internet, it's not storming by any sort of modern day imagination, but
the video.
Yeah, it's not slow though.
Yeah, it's good enough, isn't it?
I mean, I think people were saying, you know, Quake 4 was only at 1024 768 was only giving 40 frames a second.
That's got to be one disappointing thing I found about the Mac. Sorry to go off on one at the moment. It's lack of games.
Yeah.
Hopefully it will change.
Well, you've heard that developers are going to start writing for the Mac. I've read the rumours and I've read the stories. I think it was EA Games are going to start.
Yeah, I heard as well.
So that would be a big boost, I think. But obviously, for people who are moving across, they do have another amazing option that comes with these. And I think another big reason why these are going to start to take off a lot for those hybrid users or the migration users is the fact that you've got Boot Camp.
Uh-huh.
And Boot Camp, let's be honest, it essentially turns your machine back into a Windows box.
So it's more like it's a dual boot thing, isn't it?
It is.
So Windows guys are used to dual booting, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, my old, what do you call it, Plastic Mac?
Plastic Mac, yeah.
Which we're now using to produce the show for screen capture. It's basically video capture over there.
It's a TV.
yeah, that was a dual boot machine. And I make no apologies about it. Working in the Windows world, I needed to be able to have that. Plus, obviously, some of the video editing that we were doing for the other show, our Windows show, was being done on a Windows box. So now I think this machine here, the thing I noticed about it that was so powerful is I've got Fusion installed, and we'll look at that in a little bit, is the performance of Fusion. I can do real-time video editing using Adobe Premiere.
Uh-huh.
Running inside Fusion, which is essentially sitting on top of the Macintosh. Now, I've only got 2 gig of RAM. I know they come with one. I upgraded mine to 2. And
did you buy 2 from the shop, or you upgraded yourself?
No, I upgraded myself.
They do rip you off on memory, don't they?
Big time. It's actually a big improvement on these new models. It's one screw in the bottom, but it's much easier to get access to the SIMs. On the old Macs, it was 2 that were very close together, and you had to push these plastic little scrapers, and it really was frightening.
Right.
This one, they pop in and out very, very easily. So I took a Meg SIM out of my old machine. Now, I notice this one will support a faster RAM, but it also backwardly supports the 5300.
Oh, is that the Santa Rosa chipset?
Yeah. So it's a beautiful machine. I really have to say I'm very, very pleased with the purchase of it. I think it's going to do the show proud. The only other bone of contention with the machine, and certainly not for me, is the glossy displays. I know it was a bit of an issue for some people.
Yeah, I've sort of learned to live with that, because I think the MacBooks, they were the first ones to come out with a glossy display. That's it, you can't choose.
No choice.
That's it. So I sort of learned to live with it, and I've never had a problem with it.
I think it looks gorgeous looking at it now.
I think they say something. I don't do any video editing or colour editing myself, but certainly the colours look really nice on this. The screen's looking really nice.
I found a couple of articles on the internet, because I was curious just from a... It didn't bother me, but I was curious more for the show, really. And there have been people that are sort of fall into one or t'other camp, but the general consensus is it's not going to cause you a problem, other than if you're doing real sort of high-end colour matching, which I can see in sort of certain professional environments people are going to be doing that. But for me, I think it's a big improvement,
yeah.
And I really like it. So I think it's a gorgeous machine. I think what we'll do now is we'll put it away back over here. So we've got a bit more desk space. Another, just a couple of things I think we left out whilst we were looking at it. The first is, it is prone to smudging, so they do give you this little cloth for cleaning it, for polishing your baby up.
Okay.
There is...
So you thought it was a mouse mat, I just thought I wanted to add that in.
That's outright. Who would think that was a mouse mat, please? There's no magnetic strip for holding your iPod, your remote control for front row. And they do run quite warm.
Okay.
So I can't imagine how hot the extreme is, but
I guess that's because it's aluminium. You know, it could well be a by design thing.
Better heat dissipation.
Yeah.
It's not a problem. It's not like you're sitting here sort of toasting marshmallows. But if you put your hand above, you know, on the top and touch it, it is actually quite warm. And I noticed that the old Mac.
So that could be dangerous, depending on what you're doing at the time, depending on what you're watching.
Could be. So that's the new iMac. I certainly like it. I think it's a big improvement over the old one. The trouble with this is it just leads you to want to buy more Mac products. And I think that's where Apple works.
That's where they won, because I got the iPod, and I think that made me buy the Mac Mini, which made me buy
No,
this.
You bought the Mac Mini because I bought the Mac Mini, and you saw that it was a good machine.
Oh, I don't know about that.
I don't remember, I brought it round and you said, I'm sold. I'd buy it, because I bought it from the store. We set it up on your HD TV, on your plasma TV.
I remember you doing that, yeah, but I was never really a big fan of the Mac Mini until probably about 6 months after owning the thing.
Yeah.
And then I realised it's okay, only because the ITV software was running through Rosetta, I think.
But that's all obviously now...
PowerPC, what was that?
It was PowerPC, but it's obviously now universal. Everything pretty much is universal binary. So that's the new iMac. What we also want to do in the show, and I guess this is, as I think we were saying before, is where our strong point is. We want to demonstrate the actual use of these machines,
yeah,
rather than just sit here and talk. So going forward, we'll certainly be covering topics that are of interest to people out there. So
we've got planned OSX, haven't we?
Yeah.
And what we're going to do as well is learn along with you, because as I said, an important thing I want to get across, certainly, so I'm going to get blamed. Is we're not Mac experts, but
we're not.
Maybe in 2 years' time we will be.
Yeah, yeah.
But we're PC. Well, I'm a PC guy. I think you're natively PC, and we're moving to Macs, and we're just discovering that they're nice machines.
It should be said, for those that don't watch our enterprise technology show, is that you're quite a guru when it comes to
Windows
platform.
Yeah.
So it's not as if we're completely naive about IT and we've just bought a Mac and thought let's start a podcast. We do come at it with a good background of technical knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
So we want to look at the software, we want to look at the operating system, and really just sort of hopefully work through with the people out there who have just gone and bought a Mac or are new to the Mac and want to sort of, or maybe watching this to get on board thinking, do I or don't I want one? So we thought with our opening episode, what better than a transition application?
Yeah.
Fusion.
Fusion.
What were your thoughts on Fusion? You've had a lot of experience with VMware, haven't you, as a company?
Yeah, well, VMware, you probably see, well, I won't say probably, but in our other podcast, we use VMware all the way through. So
yeah.
Check out what the kind of things you can do with VMware from that podcast. But basically what VMware allows you to do, it allows you to run a virtual machine. It presents a virtual environment to whatever needs it. And that whatever needs it could be Windows XP, it could be, you know, Windows Vista,
Linux.
It could be Linux, anything. It emulates an Intel machine.
So anything that can run on an Intel platform.
Exactly. So this is great if you're transitioning from, you know, a Windows XP machine across to Mac. Because let's get real, there are going to be some applications which you won't find on your Mac.
No.
My example is I've got Universal Remote Control. There's no Mac software for that. Also, another thing, I suppose, maybe not so relevant if you're in America, the foreign demand stuff.
Yeah.
You know, we get lots of TV shows which you can watch, you can stream live, but
well, the BBC, the new iPlayer from BBC, is only available on a Windows platform.
Exactly.
DRM.
So if you've got a Mac, where does this leave you? Well, hopefully, what with the growth of the Mac, this is all going to change, and I'm sure it will. But Fusion will allow you to run on your Mac Windows XP, and in Windows XP you can run all your old applications.
Yeah.
Now you might think because it's running virtually it's going to run slow, but no. This on a machine like that, on a, to be honest, even on this, and this is original MacBook, it's not even the Core 2, it's the Core Duo, I don't think you'll notice a difference.
No.
This certainly runs better than my Vista laptop, and it's lower spec.
Isn't that unbelievable?
Lower spec.
So it's essentially going to be... There's a beautiful integration which we'll be able to show you as well.
Yeah.
Now Fusion is obviously, because it's for the Macintosh, I believe it was preceded by a different company that did Parallels.
Oh, yeah.
And you were a big Parallels fan.
I was a big one because it was the only one available. Now they're still going and they're still releasing new versions. It might be worth checking them out. Certainly on latest benchmarks, VMware just wins hands down.
And I certainly noticed that when I, and again, this was very early release of Parallels, so it's not a criticism of it, but I found that some of, you know, I use PaintShop Pro, and I use the Adobe editing software, video editing software, and they consistently crashed Parallels. Now, I've been running Fusion since the betas and then the first release. I've never had it crash once, and as I say, I do video editing in there, got some graphics work as well. So it's a stable platform.
Yeah.
I think you would agree with that as
well. Well, I think they know what they're doing, because VMware, they've been doing enterprise products for, you know, quite a while now. And if you look, that's originally where they came from. It was VMware sitting on top of Linux.
Yeah.
And now you've got ESX, which is VMware sitting on top of Unix. And I suppose, in a way, as I said, I don't know that much about ESX, but I think I'm right in thinking it's found on Unix.
Yeah.
Which is a nice sort of streamlined OS. So VMware Fusion running on top of that, it just seems very, very efficient, whereas VMware running on top of Vista, which is about that big, it's not so efficient, but hey.
So basically the idea of it is that it's really got a very, very thin layer that it's going through, otherwise it's talking directly to the hardware, it's passing everything through to, I mean, I think that's really all VMware is doing, is it's acting as a buffer,
yeah,
just to pass information through to the underlying hardware.
I believe so, yeah.
And as a result, I think you'll find that the performance figures are quite astonishing. And I know that VMware, and I don't know if Parallels is doing this because I haven't kept up with that, but it's got support for DirectX. It's only 8.1 at the moment and it is experimental.
Yeah.
But I mean, I think if they can get 8 and 9, then you're going to see game, you know, obviously you've then got support for older games.
Some of the older games.
But I think some of the stuff under 8.1, I mean, I'm not a big games player, so...
Nor am I, to be honest, without a moaned about it. the kind of games I do play aren't the graphical ones, really. It's sort of strategy. Mind you, everything's graphical now, isn't it?
Yeah, that's true. Everything's processor intensive as well. So I think what we'll do is should we jump straight into our first screen capture, show people how we kind of want the show to go in terms of that. So we'll get that set up and we'll come back. Right, so we've got the Mac up and running, and what we've got is we've got the Mac running at 1280 by 800, which is one of its offered options in terms of resolution. Now, obviously, the podcast goes out in what we call HD, even though we must apologise for the video quality. We haven't got an HD video camera yet. But obviously that allows us to display at 1280 by 720 in terms of our screen capture. So we've got a little bit of panning that goes on. But I'll tell you what we'll do. Should we start by firing up Fusion?
I think so.
So it perhaps seems a little unimpressive at this particular point. Now what I've actually done is I've got Windows XP Professional actually running on this machine because... Well, I actually use it.
Uh-huh.
So, what should I do? Should I fire this up and
Let's
then we can...
I think the other good point that I forgot to mention earlier about VMware...
Scale this. Yeah.
Yeah, the other good point about VMware, if you are a PC user and you do use VMware Workstation or ESX, the files are completely transferable between them.
Of course, the virtual machines you do.
So, anything you do on the Mac... you can, you know, copy out and run on your PC as long as you've got VMware Workstation on that.
Which is useful for you because you do a lot of lab preparation.
Well,
many
jobs
as
we've
well,
actually
don't you?
Done that on the podcast. Let's go through the settings, yeah, because I mean, when you start up the virtual machine, you are given, you know, various options. It's really quite straightforward. The kind of thing you need to do is specify how much memory you want that virtual machine to have.
Yeah.
So Nick, you've got 2 gigs worth of memory on Mac OS X, and you just got to weigh up what are you going to be doing whilst you're running, you know, OS X. What are you giving it?
I'm currently giving mine the recommended maximum. I'm giving mine 1024, not the recommended maximum, because
I don't know why they're recommending that. I'm not quite sure what that's based on.
What, the maximum?
Yeah.
Why, it's basically leaving a little bit over for for OS X. But I found that on that setting, it became... I actually found that OS X was becoming quite inoperable, and I like to be able to switch between two. So I've just split my memory straight down the middle, give a gig over to XP, and for everything I do, that's fine.
I mean, my home cinema Mac Mini, it's a Core Duo 166. It's only got a gig, and I'm running Windows XP in VMware quite successfully on 512, and that's streaming all my videos and everything like that.
Yeah.
So 512 is not so bad for Windows XP even.
No, I think because I do, let's say, some graphics work.
You're doing the editing as well.
Yeah, I do some editing work. Processors, I've given over 2 virtual processors, because you can actually limit that to 1. I guess you've probably got yours on 1.
I've done it on 1,
And again, I found no real problem switching back, you know, that seamlessness between the switching between the 2 environments. Anything else that's... I mean, the shared folders is quite nice, but I feel almost redundant with XP, certainly, because that ability to drag and drop, which we'll demonstrate later. And USB devices, it really does seamlessly sort of switch between the 2, doesn't it?
Yeah, it can be quite annoying sometimes. Because you put a USB device in it, it mounts it in the virtual machine rather than the OS X. So,
If you come up to here, down here, you've got, off the menu, you've got the ability to go to USB and then connect or disconnect from different devices. And I think my Western Digital hard drive, it's automatically just stolen on fire up. So let's go back into the actual Windows operating system. Well, that's Windows.
So you can do the resizing thing now, Nick, I suppose.
I can, yeah. Let me demonstrate that. Let me just scale that down. And look, Windows has scaled itself. And if we go in, right-click, and obviously with my mighty mouse, right-click works.
Which you didn't know at first, did you, Nick?
I don't know what you're suggesting. I might actually, if I go to settings... it's on 640 by 480, so we can tell you what we'll do. If we scale that up on here, 800 by 600,
that's
what we used to previously do our stuff on. So let's keep that setting. So it's now resized itself. So we can see we've got a Windows desktop, and... Well, I mean, it looks like Windows, and essentially it is Windows, isn't it?
To the extent you can get the security patches, and also Virus Checker you're going to probably want to install in.
Yeah,
well.
I haven't actually got around to installing mine yet, but I will do. I don't know if you saw the little pop-up there.
So. I mean, it depends. It
depends what you're doing.
Because a lot of the time you might say, well, it's just a virtual machine, and I'm only using it very, very limited. I'm not browsing on it. I'm not doing anything else. It's just supporting that one app, so it's really up to you.
I mean, I can fire up Firefox, and I mean, I guess here at this point, you know, I'm connecting to the internet. So that's, I mean, is it, do they call it bridging?
Yeah, it's probably worth having a look at that setting, actually, as we talk about it. So let's go into properties of...
Where am I going?
Go into virtual machine settings, and let's go click on network.
Network
on that. So you can see the various network settings on this one. What Nick said is it's share the host internet connection via NAT. So what this is doing in the virtual machine, it's getting an IP address from within VMware. I guess it's like running a little DHCP server in there.
Yeah.
And then it's NATing to his external IP address, whatever that is, and that's going through NAT on your firewall as well. So that's absolutely fine. The second one is the one I use a lot, connect directly to the physical network, because that gives it an IP address on your wireless network.
Gives it its own dedicated
IP address.
Yeah.
And anyone else will be able to see it as a real machine.
Within my network.
Within your network, yeah.
Sure.
So,
So that's worth bearing in mind. I'll give that some thought. So if we just cancel that off. So as you can see, we're running Firefox here on a Windows machine. I mean, we can...
Should be IE7, really, shouldn't it?
I'm a big Firefox fan, and I've kind of... it's just now my default default browser that I always put on. And I can connect through to any website with no real problems whatsoever. Now, I guess a couple of things that I like an awful lot are the ability to seamlessly do this kind of thing. If I go into my documents, I've got a little capture movie here. So if I go into, if I go back into encoded, and I think what I'll do first, if I go into Flash, I've got a little Flash player installed. So I could do something like, I could actually fire this up and watch this. So this was some content contributed to our website from one of our viewers. So,
hang on a second, this is actually a file on your Mac machine at the moment?
No, this is a file on my Windows machine, just showing, you know, any kind of player that you've got installed will work. But what I could now actually do, and I think probably the better way to do this would be, if I take, say for example, our IT Idiots show, good show that it is.
It is.
And I drag that file, and I take that over onto my desktop. I think you can see the mouse go here. I've literally seamlessly dragged from my XP professional desktop onto my Mac desktop. And as you can see here, it's copying from the virtual machine. Bit of a funny file naming convention there because of some rendering.
I mean, that's something we used to do for testing on our old podcast. So do all you could do all the development and all the editing on the Mac machine, drag it across to your virtual machine, make sure it works.
Exactly. That's a very good test, isn't it? I can, and again, it's a Windows machine. If I go into, say for example, I think I've cleared out most of these files now. But if I go back onto this desktop, that file's copied across. It's a big one.
Is that a high def one? Yeah.
Yeah, it's our high def show, and I can now play that within my Mac environment. And again, vice versa, I can, let's say for example, go into my pictures. And if there's something in here that I like the look of, let's copy, he looks like a handsome chap probably, copy that across, and that's now in my Windows environment, and I can work with that, and I assume that's probably going to, if I double click on that, oh yes, picture viewer, and that's you. So, any thoughts, anything else that you think's worth?
Well, I think they're showing the whole view, the full screen and the Unity thing. Yeah. I call it Unity, but that's the Parallels term for it, isn't it?
Yeah, so full screen, you literally click on that and it's seamless. I do have up at the top here my ability to go into the Fusion panel. But otherwise, I'm now running this full screen, aren't I? And I assume I'm capturing as well.
One would hope you're capturing.
One would hope I'm capturing.
Well, no, I just want to say that it's from that point on, it's almost like you're running Windows XP machine, and I challenge to see if anyone could tell the difference. Yeah. Particularly running on this hardware, you're really not going to have any problems with slowdown. It's just the video drivers that might cause you problems with your graphics.
Yeah,
with any games you're trying to play.
It's the DirectX type stuff, I think, that's going to cause the big problems. But I mean, I can pull up just to sort of, I'm pretty certain if I go into Media Player, I'm not quite sure what this is, but Windows Media Player.
So this is how I view all the front row stuff, the streaming stuff on my Mac Mini.
Yeah, so and it's so Windows Media Player, no problems whatsoever.
I think what would be a nice thing to show now, let's go Internet Explorer and do the alternate view. Because a lot of the times, for example, I mean, I work with Windows, and there's some websites I go to that you've got to be an Internet Explorer to use. Firefox, no good. Safari, no good. So you've got to be Internet Explorer.
It's iExplorer, isn't it?
So we could do this, no problem at all. So we're running a virtual machine, running Internet Explorer in it. But all I want to do is run or host Windows just for Internet Explorer. I don't want to see the desktop. I don't want to see any of that. So what we can now do is go up to the View menu and sort of integrate that just that one window into the desktop.
Okay.
So if you go to View and click on Unity.
Yeah.
And now check out what happens. So straight away on the desktop, you've got...
I've got two.
No. Oh, you've got Explorer, so you can leave that one open, you know, minimise that. So you can see that the windows are totally seamless with one another now. So Finder over the top of that is just to show.
If I come down here and pull up Finder, and so that's my Mac window.
Yeah, straight over the Windows window.
I mean, I could open up my Mac hard drive, and I can switch back here, and that's my Internet Explorer.
Yeah, I think that's a really nice feature as well.
Isn't it?
And especially when you've got a powerful machine like this, because you can almost forget that you're running with XP.
Mm.
Again, you might ask, why aren't we running Vista? the obvious reasons we're not running Vista is the time on the podcast. It does run Vista really well as well, but we haven't come across any reasons to use Vista as yet.
No.
Because all we're doing is, remember, we're OS X users, and we're just using XP to run the odd application.
Yeah, I mean, the idea of this show is not how to ignore OS X and get this
exactly, yeah. So, I mean, I've gone from, I used to dual boot with Bootcamp, and that, you know, it felt a little bit messy, so now I'm straight into virtual. And I don't think there's many things I use virtual technology for apart from just...
a few work bits.
Work, yeah.
Just mucking around with work. So, I mean, we just really wanted to show you so that you can sort of see that there is a sort of that ability to transcend the two. Because I will always have a need to go into a Windows environment for my job. I see it as a bit of a chore, and that's why I like to come home to my Mac, and that's what we're going to focus the rest of this show on, is the cool stuff that you can do within your Mac. So,
and VMware for when you can't.
And VMware for when you can't. So I think that probably, I don't know, what do you think? I think that about rounds
nice
up first episode. So obviously we're interested in feedback and people's thoughts. Come over to IT Idiots and... We've got an active community over there who are on the enterprise side,
yeah.
But we're just going to offer this as an alternate show, something else, because it interests us on a personal level, doesn't it? So. And hopefully this will blossom into demonstrating and showing people all sorts of interesting things with their Mac.
Yeah, hope so.
So I think on that note, we'll call it a day.
Cool. Cheers.
Cheers.